Salutations. What's up? Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to each and every one of you who are tuned in to the Movement Fellowship Telecast. Movement Fellowship is located 1140 Pratt Highway in the beautiful city of Birmingham, Alabama. We're grateful for our campuses that are in New York City, Harlem, TMFC New York, TMFC Cleveland that was just launched on the 19th of July. We're bigging up our Movement Global family that are literally across the country and around the world. For those of you who are tuned in to our YouTube channel, thank you so very much for subscribing, ringing the bell, so you can get the notifications whenever we go live. You never know when the movement is going to be moving, and you ought to move with us. So I'm thankful for this opportunity, another morning, another afternoon, to come and reach you wherever you may be and wherever life has you. So after these announcements and this intro, I'll be back. We're going to go back into leadership behaviors, leading by example. Check this out.
We are here for you. Come and do what we do. We set our hearts on you. Come and do what we do. Cause we need a move.
Thank you for tuning in again. Again, I pray that you would grab all of your family, friends, those who are nearest to you, those of you who pass at work and you want to give them an inspirational word at this very moment. As those of you who are checking us out on our TMFC Live YouTube channel, we appreciate you. You're viewing this at the same time the telecast is going on. We appreciate you more than you know. So we've been talking about leadership behaviors, the behaviors every leader needs, thinking strategically, develop and defining real vision. Last week, we talked about how important it is to inspire and motivate others. Well, this week, leadership behavior is leading by example. Can I tell you, anyone can talk about doing great things. However, an effective leader is someone who actually goes out and does it. As John Maxwell said, quote, "A leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and then shows the way," end quote. Effective leadership is set by an example for others to follow, not just for someone to hear, not just for rhetoric, but someone you can follow. I'll never forget the Saturday before Resurrection Sunday was our first cleanup day at our new movement center, 1517 Hibernia Street, here in the beautiful city of Birmingham, in the Pratt City PC section of our city. There, our men showed up 6 a.m. Sisters showed up at 6 a.m. for a 6 to 12 noon cleanup day. We were so happy, because this was our landmark purchase. It was our ability to make real ministry moves in our community. And I grabbed a rake, I grabbed a bag and put on gloves and went out. They wouldn't let me have a chainsaw, but I went out and started picking up limbs with our men. And someone yelled, "Pastor, we can't believe you out here with us." While another person yelled, I don't see why you don't believe he's out here." Real leadership doesn't sit in a cushioned office in air condition while their followers are in the blazing hot sun. Real leadership gets down into the trenches with them, because if it's worth me leading you to, it's worth me leading you through. Can I tell you, when you understand that the old adage is true, actions speak louder than words, think about some leader right now who has made such impression and impact on your life, not just because of what they said, but because of what they did. They enacted leadership. Leadership by example is transparency. It's allowing you to not only see me for who I am, but you can come to me at any moment, any time, and the leadership trait, leadership behavior will not change, because this is who I am. I'll never forget, in 2016, with a group of 18 African-American professionals. We traveled from Birmingham to New York JFK Airport to Tel Aviv, Israel. On that plane, I was one of two pastors who was a part of this 18-member delegation. We had lawyers. We had doctors. We had elected officials. We had some of the creme of the creme in the Southeast that were part of this alliance. This other pastor stood up on that Delta 747, and he said, "Listen, I'm officially off duty. Don't nobody ask me nothing about the Bible. Don't ask me nothing about where John walked in Jerusalem. Don't ask me nothing about where Jesus was baptized. I am on vacation." And he proceeded to move himself from the forefront to the background. When we landed in Tel Aviv and we made our way to Canaan, and when we got to Galilee and we went through Capernaum and all of the wonderful cities, the old city of Jerusalem, many people started having sidebars and conversations to where all 18 of them, all 17 of them, 18 including me, had their leadership quiet moment, even the pastor who said he was on vacation. I didn't ridicule him. I didn't judge him, because I understand that sometimes you need downtime. Sometimes you don't want to be norm off Cheers where everybody knows your name. Maybe you want to slide back out of the spotlight into the background, but that's not my leadership style. My leadership is 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. It is 12 hours on top of 12 hours, because that's who I am. And in those ministry moments with those individuals, I was able to share with them real leadership tools for them to go back to the crisis in life that they were facing. So as a real leader, real leaders are set apart because they're not trying to require grand gestures or enormous displays, but they are genuine people who help you to realize who they are and what they do. Can I tell you, when it comes to leading by example, you must be not only an out front leader, but you must be a vocal leader. You can't lead while you're quiet. You can't lead through your emotions. If you're going to be a leader who leads by example, you must be heard. Leaders who are not heard are leaders who will be ignored. And leaders who are ignored will be leaders who are disrespected. And before long, leaders who are disrespected are leaders who are gone. If you cannot be heard, you will be ignored. And if you are ignored, you will be disrespected. And before long, after being disrespected, they'll find them another leader. Don't allow, if you're leading by example, anybody to rob your voice. I had another situation at our church a couple of years ago. At the close of a worship service, a sister made her way down the middle aisle, and I thought she was coming to rededicate herself or reposition herself or find a relationship with God at that very moment. And she whispered in my ear, "I just want to share my testimony." And while sharing her testimony, I made the fatal mistake of 30 plus years of never doing this, releasing the microphone into her hand. Never let anybody control your mic as a leader. Never let anybody control your volume as a leader. She went on and on and on and on, like Erica Badu, telling a testimony that nobody could follow. And in the midst of it, I had to whisper in her ear, "You only have 2 minutes left. You only have 1 minute left. You only have 30 seconds left. You got 15 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. At that time, my hand was reaching for the mic. She was still talking while I pulled the mic, put my hand softly on her shoulder, pulled her closer to me, and I told her, and as I told the congregation, "Let's thank our sister for giving us such a wonderful testimony." The people began to clap because they felt rescued. The people began to clap because the testimony ended. The people clapped because now the leader had the mic back in his hand. What I'm saying to you, I'm saying don't allow anyone to hide jack your leadership. If they take your microphone, they take your voice away. When you lead by example, people are looking for you in crisis situation. September 27, 2011, A F5 tornado sat down on the state of Alabama, Tuscaloosa, making its way through Pleasant Grove, sitting down in the community of Pratt City, causing wreckage and damage throughout its path. My wife and I were living in New York at that time. I was preaching in upstate New York, and immediately after the Congress moment was over, I was ushered off the stage, and the Congress president and the president of our state convention said, call home. I said, what do you mean? Not New Rochelle, not Harlem, call Pratt City. Something has happened, devastated Pratt City. Tornado has touched down. We can't reach anybody. We don't know if your family is well. At that time, my mother was living in Birmingham, still is. My brother was living here. Our friends were living here. Our former church was here. And so I began to make calls. And I called the leader and pastor of that church at that time. And here's what I said to him. I said, I just got word. How is the church doing? And here's his response. He says, it's destroyed. He says, torn down. I'm looking at it. All the years of my hard work is gone. I said, no, the church is not gone. I said, the building might be destroyed, but the church is all right. He dropped the phone. He said, listen, I need you to get here as fast as you can. I was on the plane, Loretta and I, the next morning. When we arrived, we literally viewed the destruction. Sunday morning, he asked me to have words to our congregation, church that I had been a part of since I was 7 years old. And I looked that congregation in his face, and I said to them that I said to the leader at that time that the church was not destroyed. The building where the church worshiped was torn down, but the church itself was still vibrant. It was still alive. It was still strong, because I'm looking at it right now. The people went up in cheers. They went up in thunderous applause, because real leadership knows how to speak to the moment. It knows how to take control of a crisis, chaotic situation, and speak calmness and clarity in it. If you are a leader, you cannot panic while the people are panicking. You cannot lose it while the people are losing it. You cannot throw yourself into a tantrum while everybody is. When you lead by example, you got to step up and meet the moment with all that you have. We're going to take a moment, take a break, check out these announcements. We'll be right back after this. We were actually having church in the event center on 3rd Avenue and outgrew it in a month. September 2019, we had four services with a jam-packed at least with the minimum of 175, maximum 220 people that could fit in that building, and literally grew it in a month to two services, October, November. Then we moved to the Crossplex in Five Points West, where we were able to hold at least 505 people. That room became filled in 3 weeks. And in 3 weeks, we purchased this campus and we moved here after being 3 weeks in the Crossplex. So we were 3 weeks at the event center, 3 months at the event center, 3 weeks at the Crossplex. And now we've been here over 3 years and we're getting ready to burn the mortgage in October of this year, 2024. So it's symbolic for us. When we first drove up on this lot, I can remember that Tuesday night, the first Tuesday night in December 2019, our parishioners had never seen it. They had never heard of it, but they knew we needed a real space that we could call our own. It was the Sandusky Church of Christ. We, of course, put a new sign up to identify ourselves as the movement. And we pulled up here and five generations jumped out of cars and ran over this whole building and cried for hours that we finally had our own.
The event center was ours because Sharon and Tony Hill were connected to our church. But it wasn't ours, it was theirs. And the Crossplex was a wonderful, ingenious idea that former mayor had in his heart and his mind. But it wasn't ours. But when we came to the 1140 Pratt Highway, we knew that we didn't have to go anywhere else, we didn't have to move out, that we wasn't renting anymore, that we were purchasing a property that would be here for generations. In addition to 1,200 seat sanctuary, this event center we just walked out of, there's an additional 4.5 acres that span back like a baseball field that goes back into the city of Birmingham, and the majority of it is in unincorporated Jefferson County for us to expand. This parking lot is where I pulled up for the first time and parked and went in this building. But it's also symbolic because this is where our expansion building, our new project, is going to take place. We break ground in October. We burn the mortgage in the morning, break ground that afternoon, third Sunday. And our plan is to build all the way across and all the way back a ministry center that will rival anything in the country.
Thank you for tuning back in. I hope those announcements were effective for you. I hope that you would, in the old school church term, govern yourself accordingly. Thank you for tuning in again. Please make sure that you are connected with us. If you're on social media, check us out on any of our social media platforms, TMFC Live, and our website, tmfclive.com, where you can get all things movement. You can get our information concerning our announcements, all our campuses, times, worship experiences, mission work, all our ministries that are connected here. It literally gives you a one-stop shop for the movement. I do want to do a commercial for our health clinic. Our Movement Care Health Clinic will be opening in the month of October. We're going to have a drum roll on it and share some more information with you concerning it. But I am happy to be a part of an amazing vision that's bringing quality, affordable health care to the Pratt City residents and those who are part of the city of Birmingham. Many have said to me that this is landmark, that this has never happened before. There was a startup, Cooper Green Health Clinic, that was at Daniel Payne at one time, right after the tornado, but it sizzled and fizzled out, and now we have the opportunity to serve the citizens of the city and the citizens of Pratt City who helped raise many of us. This is truly a phenomenal opportunity of leadership. I hope you take advantage of it. So let's jump back into leading by example. Pastor E, you shared some great tools and tips and skills with us on today, but make it real personable.
Leadership. Walt Disney talked about how he walked through his parks on his way to an executive meeting and saw a piece of trash on the grounds. He immediately walked over, picked it up, and placed it in the receptacle. And on his way to that executive board meeting, wherever he saw trash, he himself, the CEO and founder, picked up the trash and deposited it in the receptacle. And they made a shockwave of leadership through the entire company that from the top down, anyone who saw paper trash on the grounds would pick it up and deposit it because they wanted it to be the cleanest parks that anyone had ever visited. We want the same thing at the movement.
Someone would ask, why would a CEO, founder, multimillionaire pick up paper in his own bar? He got people who work for him who does that. He got people on staff who can do that. That's beneath him. But can I tell you, leading by example, meaning doing what you would ask someone else to do and doing it visibly where they can see how tangible the effects are. After that, it is said that every executive from top to bottom began to embrace those same principles, that no matter what park they was in, no matter what their title was, because they saw their leader examine his leadership and him express leading by example, they too started picking up paper. The theme around Disney was, we will never have a dirty park because all of us will pitch in from leadership down to make sure that our grounds are clean. Can I tell you, if you are working with any leadership that commands without assisting, if you are working with any leadership that tells but does not cooperate, then you are not dealing with a leader who is leading by example. When you lead by example, it helps everyone connected to know that there is no task above me and there's no task beneath me. When you understand the power of servant leadership, you go to a sister by the name of Melissa Reef. Melissa Reef is CEO of Container Store. Container Store is a phenomenal Fortune 500 company. And in her organization, she promotes servant leadership. She promotes servant leadership, communication, and transparency. Riff sets an example by making sure that every employee, listen to this, knows everything happening in the company at the same time. Workers can access meeting notes from every meeting, and leadership is diligent to communicate with employees about the latest updates. It is an example of every employee following the same sincere leadership style that is leading the way. What happens when we huddle? And the leadership model of a huddle is that only one person is supposed to be talking in a huddle. If you call a huddle with the Kansas City Chiefs on offense, the only person that's going to be talking in it is Patrick Mahomes. If you call a quarterback huddle in the Philadelphia Eagles organization, Super Bowl, the only person talking in that huddle is Jalen Hurts. You are the leader in your huddle. What are you saying by example to those who are following you? When you have a leadership huddle, you know that everybody's voice counts, everybody's concerns matter. But as the leader, you are the one who they're speaking into your ear. They have helmets now in the NFL. They're developing them now where they can not only hear the play, but they can see it through a visor. So that person that is receiving the information, it is a reason why the coaches do not tell all the players to play in their helmets. They only tell the quarterback. They only tell the leader. And it is the leader's job to examine and share and express that plan and play with the followers, with the other teammates. They break that huddle. They run to the line. Here's what I loved about Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning had the ability and he had the authority. Some people lead by example because they have abilities. There are some people who lead by example because they have authority. Then there are real leaders who lead because they have both. He will come to the line of scrimmage, look over the defense, and know that they would know the play that they were getting ready to run because they had been examining and practicing against them all week. And he would call an audible. And that audible would be something like Omaha, Omaha. And they would ask the receivers who played with him, the running backs, the linemen, who played with Peyton Manning, what does Omaha mean? And they said, nothing. They said, come on, man, you can tell us. You're retired now. Ain't no shame. Peyton doesn't play anymore. What does Omaha mean? What play does it mean when he calls Omaha? They said, honestly, Omaha is a distraction. It is a deterrent. It allows you to hear something thinking you're hearing something. Omaha means nothing. It's the cadence that he gives after he says Omaha is the real next audible play. As a leader, what word do you use? What attitude do you bring that people know that an audible is about to be called? When crises erupt, when trials and tribulation come, what do you step up and tell those who are following you as you're leading by example? They do not want to hear you cry in the huddle. They don't want to hear you bemoan about the situation. They don't want you to place blame on anybody. Because real leaders who lead by example never ever have to place blame. They take it. They say that was my bad. That was my fault. I missed the throw. I missed the play. Because real leaders take responsibility because they lead by example. Well, as I close out today, I want to share with you the importance of following leadership and being the leader who leads by example. When you understand the importance of it, when you understand the magnitude of that moment, that I am following someone and I am leading others that I am willing to give my all to, put my own life on the line. That's why I absolutely love the Movement Fellowship Church. We patent our own term that says there's no place like the movement. And the reason we say that is because there are no people like the people at the movement. We're willing to sacrifice so that the greater good of everyone is our mandate. We lead with love. And this is not proselyting. This is a broadcast, telecast that we want to make sure that we are feeding you, giving to you the tools, the tips, the skills that you need to be the leader that life is calling you to be. And I want to challenge you to step up to the plate. I want to challenge you right now to do what others won't do. I can't do it. Yes, you can. It ain't me, Pastor E. Yes, it is. You are the leader you're looking for. You're looking around trying to find someone better when you're looking out, but you need to look within. I came on this morning. I came on this telecast. I came on your YouTube channel to say to you and point to you and say, you are the leader you've been looking for. If you've been looking for the kind of leader you need and can't find them, maybe it's because you're looking in the wrong direction. You're looking out to other people who may have more than you have. That does not qualify them to be the leader. What qualifies them to be the leader is the person who's willing to step up at that moment, take the reins, even though you're fearful, even though you're afraid, even though it doesn't make sense. You step up because the moment calls for it. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, honor you, glorify you in this moment. I thank you for those who are listening right now, who are finding it hard to embrace the leadership that is calling on them in this hour. Help them to know that if there was someone else better qualified, they would step up. And if not me, who? And if not now, when? We give you glory and honor and praise. In the awesome name of your Son, we ask it all. Amen. Well, listen, that's my time. I thank you for yours. Next time, join us as we go deeper into leadership behaviors, the behavior every leader needs. I love you to life. Peace.